About 18 months ago, or perhaps less, the government of India decided to attach a 4-horsepower motor onto handlooms. The reason they said was that bichare bunkar ko aamdani banana hai, to iske liye productivity banana hai, to motor chalaye to productivity bar jayega aur unka sthiti ke liye kuch pragati ho sakta hai. पर ये बहुत चुपचाप से किया. इलेक्शन आने वाला था, चुपचाप से सर्कुलर फैला देश भर में कि अभी हैंडलूम पर मोटर चलाइए. एट वन स्ट्रोक दिस वुड हैव कन्वर्टेड ऑल आवर हैंडलूम्स इनटू पावर लूम्स. पावर लूम्स इज द लार्जेस्ट सेक्टर ऑफ इंडियाज टेक्सटाइल इंडस्ट्री, द मोस्ट पावरफुल. 60% of our production comes from power looms. Why would they do this? There was no such scheme in the 5-year plan that is now ongoing, the 7th 5-year plan. No such scheme. My colleagues and I in this room were involved in developing that scheme. One person noticed this, Dr. Saida Hamid in the Planning Commission, and she rang us up to say there is a proposal to attach motors to handlooms. I don't know very much about all this, but my understanding is that if you attach a motor to a handloom, to haath ke sawal ko kya hota hai, khasiyat kahan jayega. So we said we don't know anything about this. She said you better find out. Pura desh bhar mein andolan chala. Weavers protested, we helped. My colleagues here were all a part of this. We managed to stop that idiotic, crazy plan. Where did it come from? From the very institution that Kamala Devi ji established to protect Indian weavers. And it was done quietly, surreptitiously, until it exploded. That andolan is still going on because there's no guarantee that a new government will not act exactly in the same way. But why did this happen? Why did this happen? When this crisis was at its peak, those who use hand-woven cloth, both in India and overseas, said, "Aap kya kar rahe hain? If you do what you are doing, we will stop using this cloth and India will lose the greatest cloth in the world. Why are you doing it?" Weavers were furious. उन्होंने ये पूछा कि आप 4 horsepower motor के बात आप कर रहे हैं, अरे भाई साहब 60 साल के लिए एक light, एक bulb भी नहीं है हमारे घर में, जैसे हम हमारे बुनकारी का हम आगे बढ़ाएं शाम को या जब बाहर रोशनी नहीं है. एंड यू आर पुटिंग अ मोटर, वेयर इज द पावर गोइंग टू कम फ्रॉम? साइमल्टेनियसली विद दिस वी वर इन पार्टनरशिप विद द गवर्नमेंट टू डू अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग, विच वॉज टू ट्राई एंड फाइंड अ डेटाबेस फॉर इंडियन क्राफ्ट्स. The craft sector is the second largest source of Indian livelihood after agriculture. The President of India has more than once declared that. Second largest source of livelihood. How many artisans are there in this country? Nobody knows. The estimate from the Ministry of Textiles varies between 6 and 13 million. Other estimates, 20 million, 37 million, 73 million, and our own estimate of 200 million. Where is 13 million? Where is 200 million? That is what is at stake that many lives, and that does not include half the population of the northeastern states. Men and women are all artisans there. We don't know if those figures include the men and women in Kashmir, many of whom are artisans. We don't know if these estimates include 50% of the work in the crafts is done by women. But they are the silent, neglected artisans of our country. We have succeeded, through our contact with the government of India, to include artisans for the first time in the economic census 2012. The results of that census are now coming out. For the first time, India will have some idea of what our artisans are contributing to the Indian economy. But for 60 years, we have acknowledged this as the second largest source of Indian livelihood, and there is no data. So how will investment be made in the sector if there's no data on which to make the investment? Without data, you can do nothing. And that is partly, perhaps, our fault as well. So all these years after Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay and so many others, the late Pupul Jayakar, Lakshmi Jain, and so many other pioneering spirits have worked for the craft sector, the basic information on the sector is not available until 2014, 2015. What does that say about this country? So you can take a decision to put motors onto a handloom without any idea of what you're doing or what the consequences will be. So on one side a crisis, another side a partnership. Who is responsible for this? If Kamala Devi is called the mother of Indian handicrafts, does the mother bear some responsibility for this state of affairs? Or have we as her children not done what we should have done to honor the work that she and other pioneers contributed? Gandhiji's analysis of the craft sector to this day is unmatched. He was an economist to his fingertips. He knew how to cost and price every craft product. At Sabarmati Ashram, I have seen his jottings when he was learning how to make chappals, the cost of every single thing, including the waste, and how the waste material could be used. So it's not as if we didn't know, but why did it happen? I don't need to tell you, perhaps, or maybe I do, of the whole range of craft institutions that Kamala Devi established. I don't want to spend time going over them, but almost every institution that works in the craft sector in some way owes its origin to Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay and to that other great lady, Mrs. Pupul Jayakar, who worked in the craft sector. These two great women are indeed the ones, the pioneers of Indian craft, not only for us, but around the world. It was Jawaharlal Nehru who urged Kamala Devi to work in the craft sector. And it's interesting that her work in the craft sector began with the refugees who came into Delhi from what was now Pakistan in 1947. In order to give them, in the refugee camps in Purana Killa and elsewhere, something to do which would give them hope, which would give them income, which would take their minds off the horrors that they had experienced. And that led to the first retail outlet. And that was the germ, the seed that grew into the Central Cottage Industries Emporium and many other institutions that we have taken for granted all these years as being part of the scene of Delhi and of India. A national renaissance in crafts was indeed achieved, and a global reputation for excellence in Indian craft. No other country has that reputation. No other country has an unbroken tradition of crafts going back thousands of years. China had it, broke it. Japan had it, broke it. Europe had it, broke it. We are the only country where from Mohenjo-Daro to today, the craft thread has come through intact. And yet, We don't know anything. We don't seem to care. We in the Crafts Council of India, the Craft Revival Trust, the Craft Museum, the first signal we got that something was going terribly wrong was when people at the highest levels of decision making in India, in New Delhi, referred to Indian crafts as the sunset sector. Matlab, doob raha hai, doobne dijiye. This was the alarm bell that brought us to Delhi to say, what do you mean by sunset? And we discovered that it was a feeling amongst people who plan India's future, who control India's finances, that isme kuch khas mulya nahi hai. Nice for museums, nice for festivals, mela vagera ke liye to theek hai. But for modernity, this is all nonsense. We are now a global power. We must be like Singapore or like Silicon Valley. This craft business is useless. That was our first warning that something horrible was happening. Perhaps my generation is responsible for that failure, because crafts we took for granted. We grew up with it, it was all around us. We never thought there could be an India without the artisan. We took the artisan for granted. We who worked in the craft sector never involved economists on our team. We had no idea about the economics of this sector. We thought somebody was looking after that. We didn't pay enough attention to the education sector, because the crafts cannot survive unless there are consumers who will pay for handmade quality. And that is the meaning of this title, Can the Future Be Handmade? Who is going to be willing to pay for handmade quality? You can now get Banarasi brocade made by hand in the markets of Delhi. You can get so-called Banarasi brocade made in Surat on a mill, in a mill. You can buy Banarasi brocade made in China, imported by Indian traders and sold as Banaras brocade in Indian markets. Who will know what the difference is? Unless the eye is trained, the mind is trained, and there's a value given for the handmade. This is an education process. It has to start in grade one, so that the future generation values this great industry of ours. In 1951, some very strange things happened. The Ministry of Textiles is in charge of handicrafts and handlooms. The Ministry of Textiles is in charge of metal crafts, wood crafts, cane and bamboo, bidri, stone. Ministry of Textiles? Their prime job is to look after the power loom sector and the mill sector. But the Ministry of Textiles is looking after cane, bamboo, wood, metal, copper, brass. Is it any wonder? The Ministry of Textiles does not control khadi. Khadi is the responsibility of the Khadi Village Industries Commission and some other bodies. Responsibility meaning depends how you use the term responsibility. Certainly not the way Gandhiji advocated it. Recently you have heard the Prime Minister say that we should all buy khadi, at least one item. He's right, we should. But I absolutely do not agree with him that buying one rumal or one sheet is what it's about. And that too, he mentioned, buy it at a discount. This is the world's greatest fabric. It is a luxury fabric. It is a great fabric. People should be willing to pay for it, not think that they're doing charity by buying khadi, but buying because it is so good for us to have it and to use it. And we have money in our pockets. The people who go to shopping malls don't think 5 minutes before spending thousands of rupees on luxury products. And khadi is to be bought at discount. So the whole attitude is gone a bit crazy. And it may be your job to change it for the next generation. In all of this, the artisan is quiet. They have no organization that brings them together. Rasta roko, gherao karna, wo sab ka nahi hota hai. But there are anything between 30 million and 200 million of them. That's what is at stake. But where is their voice heard? They are never heard. Dr. Sayeda Hamid, for the first time, called a meeting in Yojana Bhavan of all the organizations that deal with the artisan in Delhi. There were 30 of them. This was the first time they had ever met. One ministry did not attend that meeting. I'm sorry to say that ministry was the Ministry of Culture. Everybody else was there, but no Ministry of Culture was not. But that just shows 30 organizations in this town who are supposed to look after the Dastakar, and they've never met. They have no overview, no agreement on policy. There are no chambers of commerce, business schools don't look at this sector. It is neglected, and yet it is the second largest industry in India. Something has also happened overseas during the last 20 years or so. And that is the concept of cultural industries. A global conference on cultural industries was held in Jodhpur in 2005. And it led to a declaration on the concept of cultural industries and why they are as important as the whole world is now recognizing their importance. The whole world, it seems, except India, which has the strongest resource of cultural industries in the world. In the city in Japan and in other parts of East Asia, industry supports what they called craft cities. One of the most famous of them is Kanazawa in Japan. Kanazawa is a city of artisans, but Kanazawa is protected and developed as a cultural treasure of Japan, not by the government of Japan, but by corporations, Sony, Sanyo, and many others. And why? Because they consider the artisans of Kanazawa and other cities and villages in Japan as the source of Japanese creativity and innovation. The Honda organization has published a paper linking their automobile and automotive products to a lunchbox made by hand and sold at railway stations in Japan. The same understanding of material, the same understanding of what the consumer wants, the same simplicity, economy, lack of waste, the same attitude of quality and perfection and attention to detail. Sony, that developed the Walkman, which may now be something that we no longer use, but at one time the Walkman was all over the world. How did it start? The transistor was put in front of artisans and engineers. And the head of the design department in Sony asked the artisans and the engineers, saying, Japan has a tradition of 100 years in miniaturization. The transistor makes miniaturization possible in electronic products. What can we make in Japan that the world has never dreamed of, but we can convince them that they can't live without it? And the Walkman and other products were an output of that. We have examples of that in India as well. The entire machine tool industry in Surat, in Gujarat, was set up by members of the Panchal community.